Welcome to Power CD. The Power CD operating environment uses the multimedia power of your personal computer to make learning fast, fun, and easy. Combining hypertext links, powerful indexing, extensive search capabilities, and an online dictionary, Power CD turns your computer into an interactive educational tool. As you explore this disk, you will find that Power CD uses several different methods or operational modes to present information. The extensive online help makes it easy to navigate through these modes. The first mode you'll want to use is the Feature Presentation. Feature Presentation mode is the main multimedia program of your Power CD title. Playing the Feature Presentation is easy. It begins automatically when you start your Power CD. It combines text, audio, full-color images, and a variety of interactive features. The feature presentation is the perfect way to begin your Power CD learning experience, whether you click around or just sit back and learn. Presentation mode consists of self-playing multimedia presentations which supplement the feature presentation. These provide topical, in-depth discussions of the subject matter. Text mode can be thought of as the library of your Power CD disk. This is where you'll find things like the Declaration of Independence or the complete text of an author's greatest work. The days of carrying a heavy load of books are over. Everything you need is now on just one Power CD. If text mode is the library, then view mode is the art gallery within Power CD. In view mode, you can browse all the photos contained on the disk. On some titles, the photos are accompanied by audio captions that are read aloud, providing even more information about the photo. Even though your Power CD title contains an enormous amount of information, it's always easy to find exactly what you're looking for by using the powerful system of indexes. The main index provides immediate access to all the major areas of your disk. To help you zero in on the information you need, some documents have a local index. Question mode is a great way to see what you've learned. Just in case you're stumped and need a quick review, the questions are linked to other modes within Power CD. The information you need is just a mouse click away. And if you pick the wrong answer, you'll still get a full explanation, as well as additional pertinent information. It's like having your own personal tutor. Now it's time to put your knowledge to the test. In quiz mode, you can choose from several quizzes focused on particular subject areas. You can pick the topic, the number of questions, and even set your own time limit. When the test is over, Power CD tells you how you did and makes it easy to go back and review the questions you missed. In every Power CD title, certain words appear as blue text. These are hypertext references, which take you to a related location or document within Power CD. For example, selecting a blue text reference to William Shakespeare might take you to an index listing more than 26 references on this great playwright. Learning new material always includes learning new words. Power CD provides two ways to find a word's meaning. If the word is in green text, that means it's in the customized Power CD glossary included in each title. Just select the word to open the glossary and find a context-sensitive definition or explanation of the term. Once you've mastered the subject matter of a specific Power CD title, you should know the definitions of all the terms featured in the customized glossary. What if the word is not highlighted in green? On most Power CD titles, you can use the dictionary to look up the word's definition, etymology, and pronunciation. This dictionary, with its rapid word search capability, is easy to use. No longer do you have to fumble with an open dictionary on your desk. There's already one on your computer. Word search is another powerful tool for finding information on your Power CD title. By locating all references to a particular person, event, place, or idea, you can design your own study guide. There's no need to flip through page after page looking for Aristotle. Simply type it in, and every reference to the great philosopher on the Power CD title will be listed in seconds. As you can see, Power CD turns your computer into a powerful tool for acquiring knowledge. We know you'll enjoy this exciting new way to improve your life by learning something new every day.
This is the story of jazz, which has been called the one truly American art form. Scholars and musicians never seem able to agree on an entirely acceptable definition of jazz. And someone like Louis Armstrong or Fats Waller or some other jazz personality is always being quoted as saying that if you have to ask what jazz is, you'll never know. Jazz is essentially a way of playing music as well as a specific kind of music. Listening is probably the best way of getting to understand it. Jazz is the sound of Louis Armstrong, one of its first great artists. Jazz is the blues, all the way from long-forgotten backwoods singers to Ray Charles.
Let me tell you about a girl who know. She is my baby and she lives next door. Every morning before the sun comes up, she brings my coffee in my favorite cup.
It's the big band music of the swing era and the clarinet of Benny Goodman. And it's modern jazz as played by the irrepressible Dizzy Gillespie. Jazz was created by the descendants of the slaves who were brought here from Africa. And jazz rhythms retain the suggestion and spirit of African drum music. Perpetual toil and drabness marked the daily life of the slaves. Music was a form of relief and even of communication, for the slaves were forbidden to speak their native tongues and were denied education in the English language. In the fields, endless hours of back-breaking labor were eased by rhythmic work songs.
If you don't love me, please don't drag me around touching sugar. Like you dog me around, I know you put me down.
In the church, variations were sung around old hymns, and a new music evolved, the spiritual.
Sure do need him now.
The slaves were totally dependent on their own resources for entertainment. This picture is unrealistic, but it does show some of the instruments that were favored: violins, banjos, and, in the foreground, a crude flute-like pipe. There is more realism in this view of ragged musicians on the road. After the Civil War, increasing numbers of wandering players moved through the towns and cities of the South. Probably not too skillful, and certainly not making much of a living, but paving the way for an important musical form. That form was the blues. The blues was basically a folk music, and it spoke of the chain gang, the broken love, the wish for freedom. The blues probably started as an unaccompanied moan, closely related to the work song. It was often sung, accompanied by banjo or guitar, by country musicians like this one, a surprising number of them blind. Throughout the history of jazz, the blues has been a vital part of both the vocal and instrumental music. During the same period of the late 19th century, a more sophisticated written pre-jazz form was also gaining attention. This was ragtime. By the turn of the century, it had become the most popular music of the day, spreading throughout the country by means of player piano rolls, the immediate predecessors of phonograph records. Some of the best-known examples of this high-spirited, syncopated piano style were found in the work of Scott Joplin, a Midwesterner. That was a bit of Joplin's Maple Leaf Rag, from an early piano roll probably played by the composer himself. Scott Joplin composed a whole series of ragtime hits and even an ambitious, though never performed, opera, Tremonitia. The rhythmic sound of ragtime was also ideally suited for the brass band. The Eureka Brass Band, with a repertoire of rags and marches, was one of the many groups at the core of Negro social life in New Orleans earlier in the century, playing at all important events from holiday parades to funeral processions. New Orleans in the very early 1900s was the big city of the South. It was the magnet that drew the young and those in search of good times. Behind its cosmopolitan exterior, there was an active, gaudy nightlife in saloons and dance halls and honky-tonks. While it is an oversimplification to say that jazz was born in New Orleans, it is true that this was its focal point. And here, in places like Tom Anderson's Cafe in the bustling Storyville district, it first became apparent that a new music was emerging. This group of young musicians is on the bandstand at Anderson's Cafe. The date is sometime before 1915. But the instruments, drums, trumpet, saxophones, could be a part of almost any jazz band right up to the present. The men who played at night in the cafes often doubled in the daytime marching bands. The trumpeter at Anderson's, for example, is also the trumpet man standing at the rear to the right in this photograph of the Imperial Band, a marching group. Besides the spirituals, blues, and ragtime, there was another important element in the new jazz music, the European musical tradition contributed by the Creoles of New Orleans, some of whom had training in classical music. This was a smoother music, played in settings more sedate than Anderson's Cafe. But here, too, are the familiar brass and stringed instruments, along with the saxophones and clarinets that were a Creole specialty. From its earliest days, jazz has been dominated by memorable and colorful personalities. The first legendary jazz man was cornet player Buddy Bolden. In this dim pre-1900 photograph, he is standing behind the guitar player. The cornet player in the original Superior Orchestra was another especially notable performer, Willie Bunk Johnson. A quarter century later, he was to be the central figure in a revival of early jazz. The cornet, or trumpet, carried the melody and was the most forceful horn in a jazz group. Thus, trumpeters tended to be the most important members of New Orleans bands, and the best were given the complimentary name King. No one questioned that the title was deserved by King Joe Oliver, or by King Freddie Keppard, leader of the original Creole Orchestra. Keppard's was the first group of its kind to leave New Orleans and travel extensively. Gepard was offered the chance to make the first jazz phonograph recordings, but he refused. He was afraid others could too easily steal his musical style. So today, Gepard's name is only dimly remembered. But King Oliver went on to become a lastingly famous leader. He was one of the first to record, and many of his recordings are treasured collector's items today. From his Creole jazz band, we can get a good idea of the sound of classic New Orleans jazz, as played by two trumpets, trombone, clarinet, piano, bass, and drums. The young man seated in the center of this group is perhaps the most notable single figure in the entire history of jazz, Louis Armstrong. It is one of King Oliver's claims to fame that he gave young Armstrong his first important job in this band. But this is the very first band that Louis appeared in. At age 12, he spent some time in a reform school after a minor escapade, and it was here that he first learned to play the trumpet. Louis Armstrong was born in 1900 and grew up as jazz was growing up in New Orleans. Here he's seen with his mother and sister. At age 18, Armstrong was part of the band on a Mississippi riverboat, which served not only as an excursion steamer, but also as a basic means of transportation to the many cities up the river. The stern wheelers of the Streckfuss line, whose owner was a jazz fan, regularly employed New Orleans musicians. In the course of such jobs, they began to spread their music far beyond the limits of that one city. So far, in tracing the growth of early jazz from a variety of musical ancestors, we have concentrated on the work of Negro musicians. But in New Orleans, there was also a tradition of white parade bands that picked up many of the same musical trends. This photo shows Mardi Gras Day in 1903. The drummer in the right foreground is Papa Jack Lane, whose several bands combined ragtime with the new music of Buddy Bolden and his successors. Under Lane's influence, this group of young white jazz men developed a band that clearly borrowed from their black contemporaries. The original Dixieland jazz band soon moved north, became the rage of New York and then England, and in 1917 became the very first group to make a genuine jazz recording. In the 1910s and 20s, there were as yet no radio networks, and recording was in its infancy. But these primitive phonographs were making it possible for the first time to hear such music in your own home. Jazz musicians, aware that they had potential audiences elsewhere, began to leave New Orleans. Their exodus was hastened and eventually made permanent by a 1917 wartime measure, which closed the New Orleans honky-tonk district, making jobs for musicians far less plentiful. Travel often meant vaudeville stage appearances that were in sharp contrast to both honky-tonk and marching band settings. The man in the derby hat on stage in San Francisco in 1921 is none other than the great King Oliver. Most musicians who left New Orleans found their way to Chicago, the big city at the other end of the Mississippi River. This led to a remarkable paradox. The greatest flowering of New Orleans jazz took place in Chicago, and that flowering led to two decades of swift and kaleidoscopic changes in jazz, which we will examine in later sections of this history. Chicago was the capital city of jazz during the period that followed World War I. The period is often referred to as the Jazz Age, but this term had little to do with music and much more to do with the flappers and hotcher and hooch atmosphere of the 20s. Even in the world of music, the word jazz was used loosely. Paul Whiteman was billed as the king of jazz and was regarded by many as a sort of symbol of the period. But his huge group produced little that was rhythmic and less that was freely improvised. Regardless of the fact that its name was being used loosely, real jazz music flourished and also changed drastically in the 20s. In the bustling northern big city atmosphere of Chicago, there could be no equivalent of the daytime outdoor marching band social life of New Orleans. In Chicago, jazz spread beyond the honky-tonks too and became far more directly a part of the world of entertainment, of show business. It could be heard on a theater stage or on an ornate ballroom bandstand, such as this one, at an amusement park in Chicago's South Side. King Oliver, who had established his reputation in New Orleans, quickly became an important part of the Chicago jazz scene. His Creole jazz band exemplified the classic jazz ensemble style. The band's new status as part of show business is reflected in this hoked-up photo that was typical of the period. Kneeling front and center in the picture is Louis Armstrong, the young trumpeter who joined Oliver in Chicago. Louis Armstrong was a great soloist and a pervasive influence on the whole pattern of jazz. Above all, he was the first jazz artist to win public acclaim as a full-fledged star personality. The tradition of individual stardom that still characterizes jazz started with him. By the mid-20s, Louis had left the Oliver Band and had formed his own Hot Five, probably the foremost recording group in the history of traditional jazz. The lady in the group, Lil Hardin, had been in the Oliver Band, but by now she had become Lil Armstrong, Louis's wife. The Hot Five, whose music we just heard, existed only as a recording group. This is commonplace today, but in the 1920s, when phonograph records were just beginning to become popular, a group organized especially to make records was a revolutionary new concept. This recording card with the word race near the bottom indicates a record intended primarily for the Negro market. Early recording was a crude process. Jazz records were often made by small companies under haphazard conditions. Inside this warehouse in Richmond, Indiana, King Oliver, Jelly Roll Morton, and others played for the Jeanette label. When a freight train rattled by on the tracks, all recording had to stop. In a recording studio of the 20s, the acoustical horn in the center served as a giant ear into which the musical sounds were directed. The players lined up at the most suitable angle and hoped for the best. But recording, even primitive recording, was a dazzling forward step, and by the late 1920s, the improved electrical process came into full use. a wide variety of record companies flourished in the 20s. Some, like Paramount, were aimed at the Negro market and did a booming Southern mail order business in blues and jazz. Jazz collectors still cherish rare recordings on long-defunct labels such as Perfect and Vocalion and Brunswick. This is the British version of the famous Victor Records trademark. Even though in the 20s, foreign listeners rarely, if ever, got to see or hear the artists in person, American jazz was already very popular overseas. The artist on that British record was one of the most notable jazz figures in the Chicago of the 20s. Jelly Roll Morton was another musician who started in New Orleans and became a headliner in Chicago. He was a sensitive pianist. But he was best known as a band leader who was a flamboyant showman, flashy dresser, and boastful talker. This business card, printed somewhat later when Jelly Roll Morton had moved to New York, is not exactly modest. But the fact is that Jelly Roll Morton could be just about as good as he said he was. This is one of several groups called Jelly Roll Morton's Red Hot Peppers, which made records rivaled as traditional jazz classics only by the best work of Louis Armstrong and King Oliver. The important jazz figures of Chicago were a close-knit group. For instance, Johnny Dodds, the finest clarinetist of his day, was a member of the Red Hot Peppers, but he also played with the King Oliver Band and Louis Armstrong's Hot Five. Similarly, Earl Hines, a notable pianist whose style influenced many others, frequently teamed with Louis Armstrong. The two are shown here as co-leaders of a band at Chicago's Sunset Cafe. Among the most important jazz performers and biggest stars of the period were the blues singers. Ma Rainey, first of the great blues singers, was essentially a theater and tent show headliner. Her Rabbit's Foot minstrels toured the Negro vaudeville circuits of the Midwest and South. Bessie Smith was the most celebrated of blues singers. As a young girl, according to legend, she was discovered and trained by Ma Rainey. With her powerful contralto voice and enormous musical talent, Bessie was accurately billed as Empress of the Blues, and her influence is discernible in the styles of singers like Nina Simone and Aretha Franklin. Many of the songs that Bessie interpreted, including the St. Louis Blues that we just heard, were the work of the celebrated composer W.C. Handy. The men blues singers in this period, like Blind Lemon Jefferson, remained in sound and appearance much the same as the crude wanderers of pre-jazz days and rarely made stage appearances. Jefferson, nevertheless, was one of the most widely known Negro recording artists of the late 20s. In Chicago, as in New Orleans, black jazz was copied by white musicians. In Chicago, the young white musicians had an additional source of inspiration. This impressive group, the New Orleans Rhythm King. The three key members of this group actually were from New Orleans. Trombonist George Brunis, who remained active into the 1960s. Paul Mayers on cornet. and clarinetist Leon Ripollo. By listening intently to the Rhythm Kings, as well as to King Oliver and Louis Armstrong, and adding their own brash aggressiveness, young musicians like Muggsy Spanier and Mez Mezro built a Chicago style of their own. It was to become a strong and enduring part of the jazz scene. The major creative artist to emerge from this background was Bix Beiderbecke, a pure-toned cornetist who died at the age of 31, but has lived on as a jazz legend. Beiderbecke was first associated with a Midwestern group known as the Wolverines. In this formal photo, he's the pensive fellow at the far right. By the late 1920s, many of the white musicians who had started in Chicago were attracted to the even bigger city of New York. New York nightclub audiences had shown enthusiasm for jazz as far back as 1917, when the original Dixieland jazz band moved up from New Orleans. This band had considerable influence on the musicians of the big city. They inspired a school of white musicians who earned their money playing in the bands of Broadway musical comedies, but got their kicks by playing small band jazz. Among these were trumpeter Red Nichols, at the far left, and clarinetist Jimmy Dorsey, brother of trombonist Tommy. There was another old jazz tradition in New York centered in Harlem. Harlem had a large black population before World War I. During the war, as increasing numbers of Negro people moved north, Harlem became a black city within a city. It had its own social life, and jazz was an important part of it. The piano was the focal point of Harlem jazz at the time, and James P. Johnson, father of the exciting stride piano style, had wide popularity. This piano roll ad features Johnson and also lists his young protege, Tom Waller, later and better known as Fats Waller. New York, with its uptown and downtown jazz traditions, was to be one of the important centers of a new major development, the emergence of the big band in jazz. This will be explored in the next section, when attention is focused on the 1930s. New Orleans was the city of jazz before 1920. And Chicago was its home in the 20s. But by the end of that decade, jazz styles could no longer really be labeled geographically. The growth of radio, from local to network broadcasting, and the rapid development of the record industry were spreading the music throughout the country. As interest in jazz grew, jazz bands began increasingly to play for dancing. To fill a big hall with sounds suitable for dancing required more than the three or four horns of an early jazz band. Instead of a single trumpet, trombone, and clarinet, or saxophone, there evolved a four or five man trumpet section, plus a trombone section. and perhaps 5 saxophones. A big band of as many as 18 men, all playing and even improvising around carefully prepared orchestrations. This big band jazz of the 30s was called swing. At its height, it was music heard constantly and worshipped feverishly by mass audiences who would dance in the aisles, or even on the stage when their favorites played at the vaudeville shows, which at the time were a part of big city movie house entertainment. Big band swing developed from 2 separate musical backgrounds, typified by Benny Goodman and Duke Ellington. Goodman and Ellington were probably the most popular and certainly the most influential of the band leaders of the 30s, and both had their roots in the preceding jazz period. Goodman's roots were in the big white dance bands of the 20s, which generally did not feature jazz rhythms or improvisation, but nevertheless did provide homes for both established and aspiring jazz musicians. The transition from early jazz to dance bands to swing can be traced through the Ben Pollock Band we see here, many of whose members became the core of one of the earliest swing bands of the 30s. In 1928, this band was playing dance music in a New York hotel. Pollock had been associated with early jazz as a drummer with the New Orleans Rhythm Kings. And among the aspiring jazz musicians who found a home in the 1928 Pollock lineup was 19-year-old Benny Goodman. Duke Ellington's roots were also in dance music, but it was clearly derived from the early rough-hewn black jazz of New Orleans and Chicago. Ellington himself was first a ragtime piano player in Washington, D.C., and in the mid-20s led this small group called the Washingtonians. Another leader from the same tradition was Fletcher Henderson, whose 1922 band was this size. But the Henderson band grew steadily and rather swiftly. By 1925, Henderson had added men like Louis Armstrong, center back row, and tenor saxophonist Coleman Hawkins, seated on the left. Henderson's arrangements were becoming increasingly complex and sophisticated, but his music was still a recognizably close relative of small band jazz. The national setting in which big band swing came into full prominence might not seem at first glance to be fertile soil for the growth of any form of entertainment. When the bottom dropped out of the American economy in 1929, musicians along with millions of other Americans found themselves jobless and hungry. The growing young record industry was severely set back, and most of the small companies went out of business, leaving only the few giants like Victor and Columbia. But as the economy began its slow upturn, there were developments highly favorable for the entertainment world. Liquor sales were legalized, spurring the nightclub business. The public sought places where they could find inexpensive recreation, and ballrooms and theaters with low admission prices began to flourish. Radio provided another inexpensive form of entertainment. Many musicians had survived the Depression playing routine music in studio bands. One was Benny Goodman. When things began to improve, he assembled a jazz-style dance band and wangled a spot on a radio series called Let's Dance. His popularity led to a dramatic success at a Los Angeles ballroom in the summer of 1935, and the swing era was launched. What excited the teenagers of Los Angeles, and later the teenagers of the whole country, were the irresistible arrangements used by Goodman's band. Arrangements written by the same Fletcher Henderson who had pioneered in big band jazz in the 20s. Goodman, seen here with Henderson in a much later photograph, always made a special point of giving credit to the older band leader. Goodman was repeating a standard jazz pattern, scoring widespread success with a white variation on black-derived jazz. But Goodman took an important new step. When he organized a small unit within his band to emphasize jazz, he first featured pianist Teddy Wilson, standing here between Goodman and drummer Gene Krupa, and then added vibraphonist Lionel Hampton. Thus, the Goodman Trio and then the quartet of the late 1930s were the very first integrated working jazz units. Despite such early steps toward integration, jazz remained largely a dual stream throughout the 30s. Although Duke Ellington was a big enough attraction to be billed in far larger letters than a classic movie, it was still as part of an all-Negro stage show. The Ellington Band consistently spotlighted several major soloists, including saxophonist Johnny Hodges, still playing with Ellington in the 1960s. And at the right, trumpeter Cootie Williams. As the nation continued to climb out of the Depression, the popularity of big band jazz reached new heights. People literally idolized their favorite stars. And seemingly endless groups of jazz dance orchestras came on the scene. Here we see the starting point for three highly successful leaders. At work in a broadcasting studio is the 1935 group led jointly by brothers Tommy and Jimmy Dorsey, soon to find equal fame separately. And seated front left is their vocalist, future band leader, Bob Crosby. Although this was big band music characterized by coordinated section work by groups of instruments, the public tended to eulogize individual star soloists. Most often, the leader himself, as Woody Herman's pose here suggests. There were many band leaders whose names became quite literally household words in the late 1930s. Among the most celebrated was Artie Shore, one of Goodman's principal rivals for top popularity. Among the vocalists, who were a standard feature for all big bands, no one could rival Frank Sinatra, whose first success came as a featured singer with the Tommy Dorsey Band. With all the public emphasis on star soloists, it was natural enough for featured band members to try to reap the full benefit of their fame by becoming leaders themselves. Several lastingly famous leaders sprang from the Goodman Band, including Gene Krupa, Harry James, and Lionel Hampton, shown here. Glenn Miller was one of the few leaders who achieved top popularity, although he was not considered an outstanding soloist. He may look more like a businessman than a musician, but he led one of the most danceable, distinctive-sounding bands of his day. Despite some pioneering in mixed bands by Goodman, Shore, and a few others, big band jazz remained basically segregated. The swinging orchestras of men like Jimmy Lunsford attracted both white and Negro fans, but except in movie houses, the audiences flocked to hear their favorites in settings that were usually segregated. Among the popular black bands was Count Basie's, one of the most well-knit and long-lasting jazz bands of all time. The Basie Band of 1940 included some of the same musicians who had started with him in a pioneering Kansas City big band of the late 20s. Basie's band featured a saxophone player, Lester Young, who was known for holding his instrument at an unconventional angle. More importantly, he was one of the foremost soloists and one of the most far-reaching influences on the future course of jazz. Another notable band was led by the phenomenal drummer Chick Webb, who gave new stature to the drums as a solo instrument. His group gained new prominence when it added a young girl singer, Ella Fitzgerald, who was to remain one of the most consistently popular singing stars for the next 25 years or more. This 1941 band, headed by Cab Calloway, gives a glimpse of things to come. The young trumpeter on the left, known as John Gillespie, was to become much better known by his nickname, Dizzy. By the late 1930s, jazz was sufficiently popular for some people to feel that it deserved concert hall respectability. Naturally enough, the first such concert featured Benny Goodman. In this new setting, even the program looked highbrow. The Goodman concert was a landmark, a swinging occasion which stayed true to the name of jazz. But this is more than can be said for some other attempted mergers of jazz and the classics. Here we see Igor Stravinsky and Woody Herman. When the composer wrote the Ebony Concerto expressly for the clarinetist, nothing much happened. Big bands were not the only jazz form of the 30s. There were some irrepressible individuals who gained fame outside the mainstream, like the multi-talented Fats Waller.
My young Bonnie Banks in my young Bonnie Bray, where the sun shines bright on Loch Lomond.
Fats Waller was a singer, composer, small band leader, recording star, piano and organ player, and satirist of inane popular songs. And though he became well known primarily as a clown, he was also a magnificent pianist, a pupil and protege of the great stride piano pioneer James P. Johnson. Another unique musician of the period was John Kirby, who started as Fletcher Henderson's bass player and became leader of one of the most distinctive small bands of the period, with a smooth, close-knit style that was a clever scaling down of the big band sound. Smaller groups found eager audiences in the many small clubs that flourished after the repeal of Prohibition. New York's 52nd Street became known as Swing Street. In these clubs, casual combinations of all sorts of styles were the rule. Here is celebrated jazz vocalist Billie Holiday, backed by a small swing group led by trumpeter Red Allen.
Someday he'll come along, the man I love, and he'll be big and strong, the man I love, and when he comes my way.
Among the distinctive trends of the late 30s was the emergence of boogie-woogie as a brief fad of vast popularity. Extremely rhythmic, It was originated and developed by musically crude Midwestern Negro pianists. It was refined into a tricky and exciting style by such performers as the two piano team of Albert Ammons on the right and Pete Johnson. Fellow musicians generally looked upon one man as possibly the foremost of all jazz keyboard artists. This was Art Tatum, a virtuoso who, with his overwhelming personal talent and masterful technique, wrapped up all the piano styles of his predecessors into one super style and pointed the way for future generations of musicians. American jazz musicians, critics, and audiences have always been reluctant to admit that any non-American can fully grasp jazz. French gypsy guitarist Django Reinhardt, shown here with Duke Ellington, not only overcame this prejudice, he became one of the biggest influences on the American guitarists who followed him. By the end of the 1930s, with all the changes in jazz, anyone would have thought that the old New Orleans style was quite dead, fit only for historical research. But historical research brought it back to life. In 1940, some jazz scholars, doing research for a book, found the legendary trumpeter Bunk Johnson working as a field hand just outside New Orleans. They bought Bunk a new set of teeth and a horn. And after a time, there was a full-fledged national revival of old-style New Orleans jazz. At about this time, a group of young white musicians in the San Francisco area attracted considerable attention by playing jazz that sounded just as much like the good old days. This was the Yerba Buena Band, and its lead was followed by many other young bands throughout the 1940s and 50s. As for the mainstream of jazz of the 30s, big band swing literally became a war casualty. Here we see a huge Army Air Force band formed in 1942 by Captain Glenn Miller and staffed almost entirely by professional musicians. With millions of young men in the armed forces and shortages and austerity the order of the day, the continuance of civilian big bands had become a logistic impossibility. After the war, the jazz scene was to change drastically. Here's the saxophone section of a 1941 big band, Jay McShann's band from Kansas City, shown at the Savoy Ballroom in New York's Harlem. Second from the left is a 21-year-old alto saxophonist, Charlie Parker, who was to be the single most important figure in the modern jazz era to be discussed in the next part of this history. The history of jazz to date fits almost exactly into the 20th century. Thus, jazz is young enough for Louis Armstrong to have begun playing in the formative New Orleans era and to remain as an active performer as the 1960s roll to a close. And yet, jazz is old enough to have undergone drastic changes in form and content. It has evolved from the sound of King Oliver in the 1920s to the sound of Miles Davis in the 1960s. But both are part of the same music. The term modern jazz is used to describe the music that started after World War II. Its first sounds burst forth in the mid-40s like an overnight revolution. An aggressive, complex jazz with strange rhythmic and harmonic patterns. It became known as bebop. It was a difficult music, and definitely not for dancing. In sharp contrast to the broadly popular entertainment music of the big pre-war swing bands. Three men, Thelonious Monk, Charlie Parker, and Dizzy Gillespie, are considered the founding fathers of modern jazz. Their musical backgrounds emphasize that this strange and revolutionary new music emerged quite logically from earlier jazz forms. The musical experimentation spearheaded by these three spread across the country. Dizzy Gillespie, one of the founding fathers, is a rare combination of comic show-off and serious musician. In 1941, Dizzy was a part of the Cab Calloway Band. To Dizzy, in common with many other young musicians, big band swing seemed by that time musically stagnant and uncreative. So before long, Dizzy was off on his own. Charlie Parker was probably the true giant of early modern jazz. He had a pervading influence on the form and sound of jazz, and on the way his contemporaries and the next generation of musicians played their instruments. One of Parker's major contributions was to keep the blues form alive as a key part of modern jazz. Charlie Parker, second saxophonist from the left, came to New York with Jay McShann's band from Kansas City, home of many blues players and singers. Parker came to be known by the nickname Bird. In the beginning, the strange, angular music of Thelonious Monk, the third major modern jazz pioneer, frightened not only audiences, but many musicians as well. Yet, Monk had perhaps the most tradition-based jazz background of the three. He grew up in New York and was much aware of the Harlem stride piano idiom, and once even compared his playing style to that of stride piano player James P. Johnson. Here, young pioneer Monk is playing with old-timer Coleman Hawkins, a major figure on tenor saxophone since 1925. This is one of the many examples of mutual influence and respect between traditional and modern jazz musicians. Few old-time players commanded as much respect from the beboppers as tenor saxophonist Lester Young, a veteran of the Count Basie Band. Many modernists sought to emulate Young's light and airy sound while playing bebop phrases. Along 52nd Street after World War II, more than one tradition began to change. Working units were quite casually integrated. In this group, white pianist George Wallington is playing with old-timer Lester Young and bebopper Dizzy Gillespie. Early modern composer arrangers, like pianist Tad Dameron, shown here with young Miles Davis, did much to give this music a new kind of form. They influenced small jazz groups to use specific written arrangements, breaking away from the old concept that written music was strictly for big bands and that small units meant only loose-limbed improvising. two additional men must be included on any list of modern jazz pioneers. On the left is bass player Jimmy Blanton. Right is Charlie Christian, who introduced the electric guitar to jazz. In the early 1940s, each pioneered the solo use of what had been strictly a rhythm instrument, opening the path for many later virtuoso bass and guitar players. Both played with big bands, Blanton with Duke Ellington and Christian with Benny Goodman. While many of the older swing band leaders frowned on the new musical trend, Earl Hines, a great pianist and a successful swing band leader of the 30s, discovered and encouraged many of the new musicians. This Hines lineup includes both Dizzy Gillespie, far left, and Charlie Parker, far right. The girl at the piano is Sarah Vaughan, who later concentrated on singing. Dizzy and Bird actually worked together only rarely in the hectic early days of bebop, and this bandstand photo is even more rare because it shows a happy Charlie Parker. For the most part, these two dominant and quite different personalities went their separate ways. Gillespie always seemed to have more good years than bad. He was daring enough to put together a big band full of temperamental young bop stars. And even succeeded in drawing a standing room only crowd to Carnegie Hall. When Life magazine did a story on bebop, it was mostly Dizzy they depicted. His big band proved commercially unfeasible, but Gillespie came right back with his attention-getting, up-tilted trumpet. He said it was a musical improvement, and although no one else ever used one for long, Dizzy continued to play an upswept model. In contrast, for Parker, life always seemed a struggle for acceptance. Although his musical ability was matched by a gift for picking first-rate musical associates. Here he is recording with 17-year-old trumpet newcomer Miles Davis. And on a trip to Los Angeles, he recorded with the promising young pianist, Errol Garner, seated here with hat and spectacles. This candid shot, taken at an early 1950s recording session, is more revealing than posed publicity pictures. It shows a saddened, tired man. A man whose music was already being dismissed by some as a waning fad. Charlie Parker died in 1955 at the age of 35, and thereafter deservedly became a legend, recognized as one of the greatest innovators in jazz. The new music pioneered by Parker and the others was primarily a small group affair. The few ventures into big band bop, like those of Gillespie and Earl Hines, were short-lived. A white big band music that drew directly from these experiments was successful. It became known as progressive jazz. This band, formed by ex-swing band leader Woody Herman, produced some exciting progressive sounds. The most important progressive was Stan Kenton, whose music of the 40s and 50s was unique and richly orchestral. But these bands proved to have little staying power. For one thing, they were not really dance bands. And for another, modern jazz seemed destined to be a music of individual stars heading small units and small clubs. In retrospect, The main lasting value of such groups was as incubators for many of the leading star soloists of the next decade. A notable example is Stan Getz, the young saxophonist at the left with Leader Kenton on the right in 1944. The old-style big bands were by now almost all out of business. Only the most dogged and most talented survived, and they did it the hard way, by playing lots of one-night stands and some concerts, particularly the outdoor jazz festivals that began to become popular in the 1950s. One major survivor was Duke Ellington's orchestra, shown here at Newport, scene of the first and most famous of the festivals. Count Basie's band also managed to survive and is seen here at Birdland. The bandstand was not large enough to accommodate Basie's group because this noted New York club usually featured small group modern jazz. Birdland, named for Charlie Parker, was the center of Eastern style modern jazz. By the 1950s, geographical differences could be noted in jazz styles. In the East, the disciples and successors of the early beboppers were in the forefront. The explosive Art Blakey was one of the leading Easterners. Drums like bass and guitar were by now freed from a strictly timekeeping function. Despite their increasing musical complexity, however, the best modern jazz drummers remained definitely rhythmic. Pianist Horace Silver first worked with Blakey, but by the mid-50s was leading his own quintet. Silver is probably the most notable composer of those fusings of blues and Negro gospel music that became known as soul music in the jazz world years before the phrase was borrowed to identify the style of singers like Aretha Franklin. Drummer Max Roach, another great bebop musician, was now a band leader. Roach's 1956 quintet included two truly major hornmen, tenor saxophonist Sonny Rollins, one of the pace-setting stylists of the late 50s and 60s, and trumpeter Clifford Brown, who, though he died young in an auto accident, was a major influence on trumpeters of the late 50s and early 60s. That was the Eastern scene. In California, there was emerging something called cool jazz, based on the light, airy style of Lester Young. The first major success in this idiom was scored by the pianoless quartet led by baritonist Jerry Mulligan, left, and featuring very cool trumpeter Chet Baker. The Dave Brubeck Quartet was among the host of cool jazz groups to score major successes in the West. Perhaps the most important, and certainly one of the most widely known successes, was saxophonist Stan Getz, who evolved a new light lyrical tenor sax style that can easily be traced back to the influence of Lester Young. The foregoing should not be taken to imply a simple division of jazz into hot black East and cool white West music. Jazz is never that simple. For example, bebop pioneer Thelonious Monk and cool jazz pioneer Jerry Mulligan are seen here listening to a playback of an album they recorded together in the late 50s. And the Modern Jazz Quartet, one of the most notable East Coast groups since the early 1950s, developed a cerebral chamber music kind of jazz that is definitely cool. The cool trend in black jazz was spearheaded above all by Miles Davis, who as a teenager had worked with Charlie Parker. A top leader of small groups, Davis was perhaps the most important jazz figure of the late 60s. His 1959 sextet was the core from which several basic facets of jazz were to evolve. His pianist, then unknown but soon to become the greatest influence on young piano players, was the lyrical and introspective Bill Evans. Very much in contrast was Davis's outgoing alto saxophonist, Cannonball Adderley. Cannonball went on to form with his trumpet-playing brother Nat a band that has long been one of the leading exponents of the continuing soul trend in jazz. And also in that Miles Davis band was saxophonist John Coltrane. He was to become, before his death in 1967, the greatest force for radical change in jazz since Charlie Parker. Coltrane's career almost parallels the growth of modern jazz. Young Coltrane was in on the beginnings of modern jazz. Earlier in the survey, we saw this rare photo of Dizzy Gillespie and Charlie Parker, two of the pioneers of modern jazz, together on a 52nd Street bandstand. Coltrane is the young musician looking on. In the mid-50s, in addition to stints with Miles Davis, Coltrane worked for some time with Thelonious Monk, who also influenced him strongly. He then emerged on his own as a daring musical experimenter and fervent exponent of the free-form, newest jazz of the 60s, generally known as the New Thing. As an experienced jazz veteran, in a setting largely populated by eager youngsters, Coltrane not only stood out as a major talent, but also took on a sort of elder statesman role. He was responsible for giving many newcomers a chance to be heard on records. Here he confers at a record session with one such man, saxophonist Archie Shepp. In dealing with so contemporary a subject as modern jazz, it's impossible to hope for historical perspective. Almost inevitably, musicians who may turn out to be of vast importance will be omitted here. But some clearly deserve mention. Ornette Coleman is one. Playing his irregular free-form jazz on a plastic alto sax, he was the very first exponent of the New Thing to win public attention. And it's hard to bypass the incredible Roland Kirk, the blind multi-saxophonist who played valid jazz on three or more instruments at a time. Another musician who cannot be overlooked is Sonny Rollins, here leading his group in the garden of New York's Museum of Modern Art. Like Coltrane, Rollins was a leading voice in the now seemingly conservative modern jazz of the 50s. And like Coltrane, he moved on in search of new sounds and concepts. Amidst all this experimentation, old-time jazz never went totally out of style. The New Orleans revival, sparked by the 1940 re-emergence of ancient Bunk Johnson, continued. Bunk's clarinetist, George Lewis led this band on tours here and abroad for many years. Other New Orleans veterans, despite advanced years, were still playing throughout the 1960s in their hometown. Some of the white Chicago jazz musicians continued into the 60s to play in their traditional style. Three men, trombonist Jack Teagarden, clarinetist Pee Wee Russell, and saxophonist Bud Freeman, could still draw appreciative audiences. And Ella Fitzgerald is still ranked by many as the best jazz singer of all time. She started in the swing era when jazz musicians were reaching mass audiences. And her audiences keep getting bigger all the time. Generally speaking, modern jazz musicians, other than singers, have not reached mass audiences. But there are some notable exceptions. For instance, arranger, composer, and former band leader Quincy Jones writes television and movie scores which bring modern jazz to the general public. And Wes Montgomery, before his sudden death in 1968, was a major recording artist. Utilizing some brilliant self-taught playing techniques, Montgomery was a blues-based jazz guitarist who epitomized jazz improvisation in everything he played. This is the last stop in our tour of jazz history, but it is by no means the end. Jazz is very much a living art form, and listening is still the best way of getting to understand it. What you have seen and heard here may encourage you to delve more deeply into the past and present, and help you to keep your eyes and ears open to the future of jazz. This is the story of jazz, which has been called the one truly American art form. Scholars and musicians never
Welcome to Zane Publishing's Catalog and Information, our most complete catalog of reference and educational products. Here you'll see descriptions of our popular CD-ROMs, including many titles developed in partnership with noted authors and traditional publishers. You have the option of browsing the catalog, learning about our helpful services, or accessing additional information on this disc. You'll find that Zane's reference, home library, and special interest titles are great for both the young student and the curious adult. To find out more, you can quickly access the listings using the main index or browse the descriptions of the titles by clicking the buttons. Any of the titles presented can be ordered through our simple and secure electronic ordering program or by calling our toll-free sales number. In Help and Services, you'll find information about how to use this Power CD, how to register your purchase, and how to contact technical support and customer service. Each topic is clearly organized to answer your questions and provide solutions. Zane is dedicated to providing the best content and the best service possible. To find out more about us, click on the About Publisher button or visit our website. We look forward to hearing from you, and we hope you enjoy the following preview of some of our products. Merriam-Webster's Collegiate Dictionary, 10th edition. The Merriam-Webster's Collegiate Dictionary, 10th edition, continues the 150-year tradition of excellence pursued by America's foremost dictionary publisher. This voice of authority, which is America's best-selling dictionary, contains more than 214,000 entries. It draws upon Webster's third New International Dictionary, Unabridged, and features well-crafted definitions and pronunciations, extensive cross-referencing, accurate and detailed etymologies, and informative illustrations and tables. The Collegiate Dictionary also includes supplemental material, such as biographical names, geographical names, abbreviations, foreign words and phrases, and a guide to punctuation. Encyclopedia of U.S. Postage Stamps. The Encyclopedia of U.S. Postage Stamps features the history and a large full-color reproduction of every face-different postage stamp design issued by the U.S. Postal Service, from the first stamp of Benjamin Franklin in 1847 through the popular World War II, comic strip classics, and antique automobile series from the fall of 1995. This fact-filled CD-ROM contains more than 50 minutes of multimedia presentations by leading philatelic expert and former New York Times stamp columnist Richard Sine and renowned stamp publisher Stephen Datz. A colorful 7-hour audio-visual slideshow displaying more than 2,700 U.S. postage stamp designs, an electronic glossary of philatelic terms, and 100 interactive questions with hypertext explanations plus automatic quizzes to reinforce comprehension. Encyclopedia of U.S. Endangered Species. What do long-spurred mint and running buffalo clover have in common with the grizzly bear and the bald eagle? All are endangered species in the United States, and all are among the more than 700 endangered animal and plant species featured in this comprehensive encyclopedia. Informative audio-visual presentations narrated by leading environmental professionals from the World Wildlife Fund, the Nature Conservancy, and the Threatened and Endangered Species Information Institute gives you valuable insights into the plight of endangered wildlife in America. This incredible CD-ROM includes separate hypertext multimedia reports on each endangered species, dramatic color photos, locator maps, and state topographical maps, 131 interactive study questions, and a customized electronic glossary. The Animal Kingdom, Vertebrates Series. Survey the vast array of fishes, amphibians, reptiles, birds, and mammals that inhabit the animal kingdom through 6 titles that beautifully illustrate the range and diversity of vertebrates. Hundreds of color photos, many full screen, show the animals in their natural habitats. A text supplement providing ready, concise encyclopedic information on an individual species can be accessed for selected species. Interactive study questions and a customized electronic glossary link to each program, and automatic quizzes reinforce comprehension. Isaac Asimov's Library of the Universe. A fabulous 7-CD-ROM collection, Isaac Asimov's Library of the Universe explores the farthest reaches of the universe through the knowledge and imagination of one of the world's most respected scientific writers. You'll enjoy the vivid images, thought-provoking text, and creative presentation style that pulls all of the information together in a captivating multimedia format. Each CD-ROM includes a self-playing multimedia presentation, hundreds of images, a customized electronic glossary, and 100 interactive questions with answers to strengthen your understanding of the subject. History Through Art Collection. Each of the 9 CD-ROMs in the History Through Art collection tells the story of a different historical period, from 800 BC through AD 1900, by exploring its paintings, sculpture, and architectural treasures. You'll discover how the social, political, religious, and economic environments of each era influenced the artists and their creations. Every title in the collection features a self-playing multimedia presentation linked to hundreds of images and thousands of words of informative text. Each title also contains a customized electronic glossary and 100 interactive questions with answers to strengthen your understanding of the subject. History of Music Collection. The History of Music Collection, composed of 5 CD-ROMs, demonstrates how different cultures express their heritage through music, and shows you how to listen to musical works and appreciate different musical styles. Every title in the collection features a self-playing multimedia presentation containing a wide range of musical excerpts, a customized electronic glossary, and 100 interactive questions with answers to strengthen your understanding of the subject. British Literature, The Shakespeare Collection. This fabulous collection on 3 CD-ROMs explores the life and times of the world's greatest playwright, William Shakespeare. The collection contains informative discussions of his contributions to literature and features a selection of Shakespearean sonnets and authentic Elizabethan songs. Each CD-ROM includes a self-playing multimedia presentation, hundreds of images, a customized electronic glossary, and 100 interactive questions with answers to strengthen your understanding of the subject. The Crime Collection. Written and narrated by renowned true crime author J. Robert Nash, The Crime Collection puts you face to face with a blood-curdling gang of murderers, assassins, con artists, and mobsters. On 6 CD-ROMs, you'll learn about the crimes, victims, investigations, trials, and punishments. Each title features a self-playing multimedia presentation, hundreds of photos, a customized electronic glossary, and 100 interactive questions with answers to strengthen your understanding of the subject. This remarkable collection will provoke hours of fascination for criminologists, law enforcement officials, armchair detectives, anyone who's interested in the darker side of human behavior. Encyclopedia of the JFK Assassination. Written by internationally known JFK assassination researchers Bob Harris and Jane Rusconi, director of research for the popular Oliver Stone film JFK, the Encyclopedia of the JFK Assassination guides you through the assassination and the subsequent investigations. This fascinating CD-ROM includes a 36-minute multimedia presentation, 20 original essays on the assassination, linked to more than 10,000 hypertext pages of original source evidence, more than 500 photographs, the complete Warren Commission report, the revealing House Select Committee on Assassinations report, and 163 provocative questions with more than 600 hypertext explanations, plus automatic quizzes to reinforce comprehension.